There are many people here in the room who are deeply involved in this project, and specifically about boson sampling, quantum information, and I will introduce you to them during the talk. And this is a joint work with Guy Kindler. So this is the first time I talk about it. I think Guy talked about it in Turkey. Our lectures are fairly complementary, but I will not require knowing what he talked about. So we start with determinants.
Was it one of you is right?
What?
One of you is right?
Yeah, it's most one. It's most one for us, yeah. No one said there was a talk in the rationality center about certain theories regarding the scrolls of Qumran. And the speaker said there are certain conflicting theories, and therefore just one of them is right. And I will tell you which one is right. And then somebody raised his hand and said, at most one of them is right. Anyway, so determinants and permanents. So just so I'm sure you all know, but I will define. So if we have a matrix Aij, then the determinant of, say, I and J, it's an n by n matrix. The determinant of the matrix is the sum of Ai pi I over all permutation with a sign, with the sign of the permutation.
We're missing a product.
A product, yeah, product I from 1 to n. So you look at the matrix and you look at all the diagonals, so generalized diagonals, and you take the product of the entries, the product of the entries, and sum them with plus minus one signs, signs according to the sign of this permutation. So this is the determinant of A, and the permanent of A is something very similar without the sign. So it's actually a little bit simpler. Pi over Sn, the product of Ai pi. Overall. So this is a sum of n factorial terms, and this is a sum of n factorial terms. And miraculously, determinants are fairly easy to compute. So, you know, they are not so easy, but you don't need to make an n factorial computation. You can use Gauss elimination and compute the determinant in polynomial time, something a little bit more than quadratic or something like that. And the permanent is notoriously difficult. It's very difficult to compute permanents. There is a whole computational complexity class called SharP, which reflects the difficulty, the hardness of computing permanent. And it is known that to compute permanent is something which is even harder than what the so-called polynomial hierarchy. So it's very hard. And there's a lot of work about permanents, about determinants. There is one miracle which happened in our academic life, which is that it was discovered that it's easy to compute, to approximate permanent of positive matrices. This was an achievement which was done in two steps. In 1990, Jerome and Sinclair proved that it's easy to compute permanent of dense matrices, to approximate permanent of dense positive matrices. And then 10 years later with Vigoda, they did it for the general case. So this was quite a startling result. But generally speaking, to compute or to approximate general permanent is difficult. Okay, so I should mention that if you have any questions, remarks, corrections, let me know immediately. And now I think there are some physical gadgets, which I will tell you very little about, which are related to permanents and determinants. So there are bosons. So these are the two major types of physical entities in particle physics. There are bosons, and a primal example are the photons. And they are indistinguishable particles obeying the Bose-Einstein statistics. And the bosons, computing the state of a boson reflect in a strong way that I will explain computing or permanence. And there are fermions, which are also indistinguishable particles, but they are obeying the so-called Fermi-Dirac statistic. And they are, to compute their state, you need to do a determinant. So there was a, and I will explain a little better what I mean. There was a talk here, I don't know, maybe 20 years ago, where Avi Vigdorzon talked about permanent and determinant. And then Tali noted the connection to physics, and he said jokingly that the role of that it's much harder to be a boson than to be a fermion. Right? I don't know if you remember that. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So maybe I should tell you a little bit. So the way we think about it, both a single boson and a single fermion is a particle that can be in M modes. So we describe it by looking at M boxes, and the boson can be here, or it can be here. So it can be one of these spaces. And this is the same both for a bosons and fermions. Now, bosons, when we have K bosons rather than one, the boson can occupy K places, K boxes. And the bosons, we don't distinguish between them, and they can occupy the, many bosons can occupy the same box. So the position of the boson, they reflect choosing K elements, or K boxes from N elements with repetition. So these are bosons.
Now it's the opposite of what you have in the slide.
What?
It's the opposite of what you have in the slide.
Yeah, this is not very surprising. Yeah, it's the opposite, yeah. Okay, so this will be the opposite. And so these are bosons. The fermions, so again, a single fermion corresponds to choosing one mode for this fermion. But then there is a rule, the fermions cannot occupy, the two fermions cannot occupy the same place. So fermions correspond to choosing K elements from N elements without repetition. And now, so this is the basic statistics. Now, a single boson, this is what's wonderful about quantum physics. Although these are, it can be in a superposition of several such positions. And I will tell, so this superposition is some probabilistic distribution or quantum probabilistic distribution. So it can be with probability 1/2 in this position, probability 1/2 in this position. But make it even slightly more complicated is that this probabilities are represented not by real numbers, but by complex numbers. So it can be in this state with coefficient 1 over, a superposition with coefficient 1 over square root 2, and in this state with superposition 1 over square root 2. And similarly, if you have K bosons, they can be in some big superposition among choosing K elements for elements. So I should say about going back to combinatorics, so you see this is related to very simple combinatorics. Some of you study discrete mathematics, and maybe few of you even study discrete mathematics when I was the teacher, like Nadav. And this is one of the basic things we do, choosing K elements from N elements, with repetition, without repetition, with where the order is important, but the order is not important. And after teaching discrete mathematics for many years, in more recent years I taught a course which is sort of mathematics for poets or mathematics for humanity students. And I also taught them this thing. And at the exam, I asked them a question in how many ways you can choose a committee of three members from a class of 10 members. Yeah, I wanted to make it as simple as possible. And then somebody in the exam raised his name and said, I know the answer, but I just want to make sure that I'm on the right track. So I said, yes, yeah, in how many ways? And he said,
in four ways. With repetition, with repetition, no, it's not important. So, okay, so I said, no, this is not what I meant. I went home and I told this story to my son, Elio. I said, you know, this is what happened to me. In how many ways you can choose a committee of three members for 10 people? So my son said, oh, there are many ways. You can choose it democratically. Majority rule, you can choose one delegate from the boys, one delegate from the girls, and one delegate by the teacher. That's so good. And then I told the, I went to my former PhD supervisor, Micha Perles, and I asked him, told him the story. And he said, yeah, he was actually, when Adav took the discrete math, we were teaching in parallel. And Micha said, how many ways you can choose a committee of three members from 10 members, but it's a huge number, because first you have to choose the class of 10 members. So I'm going to choose the classes of 10 members. So, okay, so in any case, the K bosons correspond to some mixture, some superposition of putting K elements in box where with repetition and fermions without repetition. And here, as we will see in a minute, permanents and determinants are occurring. So we now move to the actual talk, and boson sampling and fermion sampling. So boson sampling is the following computational task. The input is an n by m complex matrix whose rows are unit vectors. So we have a matrix which is n by m. Yeah, sure. N by m. So this, and the output is a probability distribution of multiset of size n from the set 1 up to m. So we can think about it, we choose a multiset of columns. Now, what is a multiset? A multiset is just like set when we allow repetition. So we can choose two different columns, or we can choose the same column twice. And now the output is a probability distribution on multiset of size n from 1 up to m, where the probability of the multiset is proportional to the square of the absolute value of the associated permanent. So here we have an n by m complex matrix, A11, A12, up to A1n. Here A1m, An1 up to Anm. And we can assume, let's assume that all the rows are unit vectors. So the sum of the absolute squares of the values in a row is 1. And for any submatrix, n by n submatrix, where we also think about repeated columns, we compute the permanent, we take the absolute value of the permanent, we take the square, and this is the probability we give to this multiset of columns. I cheated a little bit because when there are repetition, we need some further normalization factors that I will ignore. Okay, so this is a boson sampling. And now the nice thing is, now fermion sampling is the same, but with permanent replaced by determinant. So here, instead of sampling according to the absolute value of the permanent of the submatrix squared, we sample according to the absolute value of the determinant of the submatrix squared. And the boson sampling, the amazing thing is that boson sampling can be demonstrated by a system of n non-interacting bosons, say photons, and of course by a quantum computer. So I don't know, I'm sure all of you heard about quantum computers. Quantum computers are very general class of computers that can model quantum physics and do computation using effects of quantum mechanics. And quantum computers can, ideal quantum computers can perform boson sampling without any difficulty. They can also perform fermion sampling without any difficulty. But for boson sampling, we don't need the full apparatus of quantum computer. We can have something very simple
a physical system, which is some sort of n interacting bosons. Now, you may know that for building quantum computers, there is a major problem of fault tolerance. And indeed, if you have noise and you can, and you have a fault tolerance apparatus, then you can also achieve boson sampling with negligible errors on a noisy quantum computer. Okay, so this is a boson sampling. And this is very nice because this shows that quantum computers can sample according to the absolute value of the permanent squared. And this is surprising because even quantum computers are believed not to be able to compute permanents. So computing permanents or even approximate permanents is believed to be intractable, not only for classical computer, but for quantum computer. But they can sample according to the exact value of the permanent. So here is
this doesn't lead immediately to some contradiction?
No.
Put the matrix there and you put some stuff.
Certainly not immediately, because we know about this for maybe two decades and people, but from it leads immediately to some contradiction, but then it turns out that this is wrong. So this is something that I had this several times and then I told it to somebody else. I also thought about it. So you think that maybe you can use it to compute permanent or to approximate permanent, but then when you think further, you see that your ideas don't work. Right. So let's move on.
Maybe it's worth to comment that to sample according to the permanent means that you get one sample out of exponentially many, and all you know is that the probability of getting that sample was proportional to some permanent.
Yeah, the other way is easy.
Repeat it many times.
But yeah, you can repeat it many times. You can certainly, for example, you can compute very accurately what is the probability, the sum of all the permanents which contain the first column compared to the sum of all the permanents. But it doesn't give you a way to compute permanent. We believe that computing permanent, we are an orchestra. Computing permanent is intractable. So here is a suggestion of Aaronson and Arkhipov from a paper from 3 or 4 years ago. I think Scott Aaronson talked about it in our seminar. Several years ago, maybe 5 years ago, very nice. So it has the following four bullets. One, classical computers cannot serve as permanent machines or as for boson sampling unless the polynomial hierarchy collapses. So this is a theorem. It's a very nice theorem. If you can do boson sampling on a classical computer, then this has a very severe computational complexity consequences. The polynomial hierarchy will collapse to the third level. Second, it is plausible that we can achieve, without quantum fault tolerance, an approximate version of permanent machines. So this was the second idea. The third idea, which is a conjecture, serving as approximate permanent machine, serving to do approximate boson sampling is also likely to be computationally hard for classical computers. And then comes the conclusion, which is by doing approximate boson sampling, we will have a quick and forceful demonstration of quantum supremacy or of the falsehood of the efficient Church Turing thesis. So let me say a little bit what I mean by here. As you know, quantum computers can do computations that classical computers probably cannot do. This fact has several names. Sometimes it's called quantum supremacy. This is a term by John Preskill. Sometimes it's called the falsifying the Church Turing thesis, which says that no computing device can go beyond what digital computer can do even when you talk about computational complexity. In any case, this is, of course, this is demonstrated by Shor's famous algorithm, and this will be a very quick way to do it. We will build this apparatus of maybe 20 or 50 photons that will approximate the distribution. And if we can do it for fairly modest number of photons,
or maybe by some other implementation, this will prove, or this will be a convincing demonstration that quantum mechanics offer a superior computational power.
How do you know if you're correct?
Yeah, so when you, this is an excellent question. So if you're talking about moderate numbers, you can still run also a classical computer, which will take more and more time. So you can take supercomputer that will compute the distribution, say 30 by 30, to take a 1,000-year CPU, and here you will do it. So you will check that you are correct. But you are right, if you move even further, there is a very principal question, how to know that you are correct, and this is a very important question in quantum computation. Okay, so this is the idea. I see. Let me mention two computational complexity problems. Because I will not talk about the complexity so much, but I want to mention one is that approximating the permanent of the Gaussian random matrix. So Aaronson and Arkhipov proposed to consider random matrices as input, Gaussian random matrices. There were several both theoretical reasons and practical reasons why they thought why they suggested it, and we will concentrate on this. But they needed a conjecture to justify the second point. To justify point number two, they needed a conjecture. I'm sorry. They needed a conjecture which says that even approximating the permanent of a random Gaussian matrix is sharply hard. I think this is a too strong conjecture to be true, but what they really need is that approximate the permanent of a random Gaussian matrix is not in the polynomial hierarchy, and this weaker statement is fairly reasonable. Another conjecture, which I had in reaction to their paper, is that they proved that a classical computer which can do boson sampling caused the hierarchy to collapse, but I conjectured that even if you have a classical computer with a BQP subroutine, you cannot perform a quantum sampling or boson sampling, which means, this conjecture means that the sampling power of one computer is much stronger than the power of one computer for decision problems. Or at least this is an interpretation. So this is another interesting question. But let me move forward. So implementing boson sampling. So I should say that boson sampling, more or less in this way, appeared in an early paper by Tali, Tishby, and Lidor Troyansky. Lidor Troyansky in 96. So I don't know if this paper was after the famous joke, or this famous paper, I would say, or this was a reaction. It came out of the joke. Yeah, so this is what I conjectured. So they wrote a paper essentially proposing boson sampling, not so much as a sampling as a sampling problem, but for the purpose of approximating the permanent. And essentially they describe a very simple realization using scattering and photons, which is one of the proposals people are trying to do it now. And so this is Tali Tishby, so I should ask the guy who take the film. I recently prepared some filming of videotape lecture, and all this directing really attracted me, so now I can. So this is Tali Tishby, and this is Steve Weisner, who is one of the fathers of quantum information as a whole. And this guy there is Nadav Katz, who is going to implement boson sampling in the next 5 years. And there are many other people here.
The money back.
What? No, you shouldn't, because if it will be interesting both ways. Okay, so Troyansky and Tishby proposed a very early a way to implement it. And there are various proposals which relate to very exciting experimental physics to implement boson sampling based on photonics or based on superconducting qubits, which is one of the most important way towards quantum computers, or based on trapped ion qubits.
So Gil, except for the role that you described, is there any inherent interest in carrying out this kind of sampling?
do you mean?
Why do people, is this just to test the theory?
Look, this is a...
Why do people care about the problem?
Okay, this is a good, well, first of all, if you demonstrate this quantum supremacy, or this is this will be an off-scale development, even for the highest scientific recognition. So this will not, I don't want to be more specific, but this will be something amazing. Now you ask, is there some other application? And I think one of the things that Scott and Alex are bragging about is he will be able to prove the concept of quantum supremacy without doing anything useful. But I'm not sure that there is nothing useful for boson sampling. There is something very simple, which is Fourier sampling, which is extremely useful in quantum computation. And I'm not convinced that this cannot be used for other algorithms, but so far we don't know other applications.
Yeah, you should say that boson systems are extremely important for physical reasons.
For physical reasons, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah,
superconductivity or things like this, all both based on boson statistics, which, or superfluidity, actually.
Right, right. Better. So this is certainly so cool.
These things exist.
Definitely, definitely. I think this is, even for bosons, this is a very simplified notion, because these are non-interacting bosons. So this is really extremely simple physical system, and from the point of view of computational complexity, it gives you the full mounty of hardness, but certainly one of the important application of quantum computing, computers, will be to simulate quantum physics. Okay, noise. So now I come to the second part, which is noise. And now I want to tell you about an idea, which is noise sensitivity, noise stability. This is an idea, I will first present it. You see, we are here living in the world of Gaussian variables, and I will move a little bit to describe things in the world of Boolean variables. They are very similar. Actually, the Gaussian are simpler in various respects, but for us combinatorialists, the Boolean are somewhat simpler, and also this is how this series started. So now we look at Boolean functions. And 0, 1 to the n is just the discrete cube. It's just a set of all 0, 1 strings of length n. And when we have a vector x in this discrete cube, a noisy version of x is described by taking y, where yi is equal to xi with probability 1 minus t, and yi is equal to 1 minus xi with probability t, independently. So you flip every bit with probability t. So this is a noise, and a sequence of Boolean function is noise sensitive if the correlation between the function for the original input and the function for the noisy input is going to 0. So this is the notion of noise sensitivity. And it turns out that this is a useful notion in the study of Boolean functions, both for application in probability theory and for application in combinatorics and other areas. And we studied it in 1999. And actually, we are quite proud of this year, because in the year 2000, something very similar occurred in the context of the US election, the noise sensitivity of the election rule. The X could be the vote of the people, and the Y was the mistaken vote. And we saw that in this case, the election were fairly sensitive to noise. And but we studied before. And one of the theorems that we proved is that the planar, the crossing event for critical planar percolation is noise sensitive. I will say what it is in a minute. And the key observation is that essentially Boolean functions are stable if they are close in some sense to the majority function. The majority function is stable and other functions are not stable. And then we during the year we studied, various people and also me, we studied all sort of variation of this noise sensitivity. And in particular, there is a result by Ofer Zeituni and me, which says that if you look at a random Gaussian matrix, so now we move back to the world of Gaussian,
although this time it's Gaussian real matrices. We look at the Gaussian real matrices, we look at the maximum eigenvalue, and we ask at the event that this maximum eigenvalue is bigger than its median, then this event is noise sensitive. If you make a small noise, then the correlation go to zero. So this is in a very intuitive and non-accurate way what noise sensitivity is, and maybe I will just demonstrate for planar percolation. So this is a picture of the model of planar percolation. So you look at the n by n grid, like daf b'machberet cheshbon, and you take every edge with probability 1/2. And you get this type of random graph. And the event we're interested is the pass from the right to the left. What is the probability that there is a pass from here to here? It's about 1/2. Because we have, out of symmetry, it's about 1/2. But the surprising thing is, if you take this picture and you draw only epsilon of the edges again, then the correlation between the crossing probability go to zero. So we'll have two pictures that if you put one on top of the other, they will be almost identical, but still the event, the crossing event, will be uncorrelated. So the noise have very strong effect. And this have a very nice, this has a nice application in percolation theory. Unfortunately, we cannot prove it in higher dimensions. So here is actually, here is Benjamini, Itai Benjamini, Odel Deshram, and myself, some years after this paper. Let me mention, so I will mention altogether about 10 problems. So let me mention a few problems about noise sensitivity. So one problem, to study noise sensitivity of interesting random graph properties, like connectivity or non-circular ability. The other problem is to show something similar, but for the three-dimensional model, to show that the crossing event for critical probability in three space is noise sensitive. We don't know how to do it. And now the next two questions came already from my work with a guy, although we should have thought about them before, but... So the problem number five is understand noise stable instances for noise sensitive function and noise sensitive instances for noise stable functions. So noise stability and noise sensitivity are sort of statistical properties, but sometimes for specific instances we have opposite behavior. And the sixth problem, what is the computational complexity of noisy function? You take a function, you take a Boolean function, you apply noise. What is the computational complexity of the noisy function? What is the average case complexity? What is the worst case complexity? Are robust instances computationally feasible?
What do you mean the complexity of noisy functions?
You take a function, and you apply this noise operator. And you ask how difficult it is to compute the noisy version, say, for a random input.
It's a distribution.
No, you take a function of the input. It can be a real function. You apply the noise, or it could be, say, integer. You apply the noise, you ask what is the computational complexity of the noisy version? Or what is the average for a random input, for the worst case input? So there are questions which are fairly natural. Okay, and now there is another piece of information that I will tell you more as an appetizer than as something that you will come out from here and you'll be able to work with it. And that's that the noise sensitivity is intimately related to Fourier expansion. So when we talk about Boolean function, noise sensitivity is intimately related to the Fourier-Walsh expansion. We talk about Gaussian variables, it's intimately related to the Fourier-Hermit expansion. And essentially, don't look at the slide, look at me. Essentially, noise sensitivity tell you that the coefficients are up there. They are not, the Fourier coefficient, the Fourier coefficients are indices, or multi-indices. And so they are, the indices has some grading, size of the set, or some of the entries of the vector. And if the Fourier coefficient is supported by large frequencies, then it is noise sensitive. And if it's supported by low frequencies, then it's noise stable. And I will not tell you more about it. I just said this is a... Okay, and then like in the Boolean case, we can translate it to the Gaussian world, and there is a paper by Guy Kindler and Ryan O'Donnell from 2012, and there the basic setting is X is a Gaussian variable, and we replace it by a combination of itself with another independent Gaussian variable. So this is the setting, square root of 1 minus Tx plus square root of T of Y. T is the level of noise, and there we need to redevelop the theory. There are some aspects which are actually easier, some aspects which are not so easy, and the key things to remember is that the harmonic analysis used here is to use Hermit polynomial instead of Walsh polynomial. So again, if you have a clear picture of what I'm talking about on this, this means that you already knew it before the lecture. But I hope it gives you some. Okay. So now we come to the third part, the complexity.
Perhaps you will not know it after the lecture.
Yeah, it happened to me sometimes that I came to a lecture where I have a feeling of knowing some area, and I left. Yeah. Okay. So now I want to tell you the main work, the main result with Guy, and I'll tell you shortly, so this is sort of a technical, but not terrible, then we'll talk about the interpretation, and then, okay, so here is the theorem. So we look, if you remember, the boson sampling is sampling according to a very large, exponentially big a vector, where the entries are permanent, the absolute value squared of the permanent. And here this theorem deals with a single entry, and it says the following: let F denote the absolute value of permanent squared for an n by n Gaussian complex matrix, and let G denote the average value of F over Gaussian t perturbation of the entries. So this is precisely what we did before. With F, we look at the permanent. With G, we take the matrix, and then we take we average over the perturbation of the matrix, where we add some additional Gaussian noise, take the average of the absolute value. And then we have the following. So this is one single entry in the boson sampling distribution. Then our theorem says the following: if T is a constant, then G can be approximated by a polynomial time algorithm. So the noisy version for a constant level of noise can be approximated by a polynomial time algorithm, and not only by a polynomial time algorithm, but by a bounded depth polynomial time circuit. So polynomial time algorithms we are not happy because we want more, but what the computers can do is quite substantial. But here, after you introduce the noise, the noisy version of the function can be approximated by bounded depth polynomial time series. Very, very low complexity class. Now, if the noise is not constant, but it's above 1 over n, then the correlation between the noisy function and the original function go to 0. So we have here two effects. One is that the complexity become very, very low for a noisy version for a constant amount of noise, and even if the noise is fairly small, the correlation goes to 0. And the key observation is sort of a nice observation. We look at the Hermit expansion. We look at the Hermit expansion of this function f. Now this Hermitian, the L2 norm of f is something that was known before, and it is n plus 1 times n factorial square, and it turns out that in each level, you have the same contribution. So it's very, very simple. And this gives you the precise Hermit expansion, the precise contribution of each level on the Hermit expansion. And this allows not only to prove this theorem, but to give a fairly precise computation. So this is what I will tell you now. So this is a precise formula for the correlation of the noisy function and the original function, and here it's how it looks asymptotically when the level of noise is C over N. And here it's even a table. We even were able to draw a table. This is an achievement.
And this gives you the correlation when the level of noise is 1 over 2n, 1 over n, 2 over n, and so on. Okay, so there are, so what is interesting here, there are two phenomena. If the noise is constant, which is the usual assumption in a fault tolerance computation, if the noise is constant, then the noisy function is very, very low level complexity wise. And if the noise is above 1 over n, then the noisy function has no correlation with the original function, a very easy correlation. Okay, now there are several issues if you want to move from a single permanent to the whole boson sampling, and I think these issues are not so difficult mathematically. I will mention what they are, so I think we can handle them. One is that, well, there is some technical issue here, is that we don't assume that the rows are orthogonal. And assuming or not assuming that the rows are orthogonal is like the two models in graph theory, one GNP and one GNM. So in our case, the rows are almost orthogonal, but just this is the outcome of the model. But anyway, this is a technical matter. But in any case, we want, if we're talking about computational complexity for a fixed amount of noise, it looks that everything go over easily. We need to handle also permanents with repeated columns, but we need very, very, the fact that the noisy function on average belong to bounded depth computation is a very, very general fact. It uses almost nothing. And it applies both to the entries when we have repeated columns and to the normalization factor. And here we had some subsequent work also with Maya Leshkovich, which seems to settle this matter. Now, for noise sensitivity, if m is much larger than n squared, then we don't have this repeated columns phenomena. And when we don't have this repeat, and there are many results about boson sampling which make this assumption. And then again, moving from the single entry to distribution seems easy mathematically, because we have because most of the terms don't have repeated columns, and because the normalization term is highly concentrated. And we believe that the result should apply also whenever m is greater than 1 plus alpha times n, but this will require some things which look manageable, but sort of difficult, because we need to deal with the case where there are repeated columns. There, the combinatorics is not as nice. We don't have closed formulas, so we need to do some asymptotic computation. So this is some work, but I'm quite sure that the results apply when it comes to correlation. The correlation go to zero when the level of noise is above 1 over n, and the computational complexity is this very, very low level complexity when the amount of noise is constant. Okay, so there are now two technicalities that I want to, they are sort of important. They hide some conceptual things, so I want to mention them. One technicality is about our noise model, which is really sort of seemed to be taken masharvul, I don't know how to say it. Well, suddenly, the reason we thought about this model, because this is mathematically accessible, but there was some physical motivation, is that we had this schematic picture from implementing, where you build separately the n bosons, and then you put them together and create some interference between them. So this is schematic, very unrigorous. And then if you don't build the bosons initially according to the Gaussian, this Gaussian state that you want, but some perturbation of it, or Gaussian perturbation of it, then you get precisely the type of noise we propose. So our proposal seems to be sort of reasonable, but more importantly, we regard the model as relevant because we expect that mathematical properties will extend to other modeling of noise. So I should mention what are other modeling of noise, but this is sort of important. One important form of noise is mode mismatches, which is the phenomena that the indistinguishable bosons are not totally indistinguishable. So somehow the environment keep the history of the bosons before the interference. And this is a very nice mathematical description. And the nice thing is that there is a nice mathematical description of mode mismatches that was proposed by Greg Kuperberg. And when you look at it, our methods apply immediately to it. There is some combinatorial twist about the type of permutation or some nice combinatorics, but all the results are the same, and the table will be slightly different, but not very different. You can also talk about multiplicative unitary noise. This should not make a difference. The additive form is sort of the Lie algebra analog of the Lie group in this case. And you can talk about inaccuracy of beam splitter and phase splitter and the unheralded the photon loss and other things. There were some related results. And we conjecture that all our results extend to all these forms of noise with similar quantitative behavior, the same qualitative behavior, that constant level of noise, very low computational complexity, above 1 over n, the correlation go to 0, and quantitatively it's fairly similar, and the Fourier Hermit expansion will also be useful for all this type of noise. But this can be mathematically a bit more challenging. Okay, the second technicality is that we deal with L2 and not with L1, and indeed the particular papers usually deal with variational distance, L1. So of course, it's not entirely clear why L1 is so important. No, how do you say L1 in Hebrew?
El-Echad,
yeah. So maybe the Hebrew term, El-Echad, explain why L1 is so important. But this was supposed to be a very sophisticated joke. I hope you have Nazis on tape saying we can use it for some future. In any case, one can conjecture that the problem is to clarify noise sensitivity behavior of permanent A squared and boson sampling with respect to the L1. Here again, we did some simulation, and it looks that the L1 distance behaves somewhat worse than the correlation. But we don't have the complete picture, so we don't know. So here I don't swear that the mathematics is going to be easy or even feasible, but I think it's quite interesting. There can be simulation. Okay, so now I want to mention that my direction for future research is to extend the noise sensitivity and Fourier Hermit expansion for more general and interesting example of quantum system. So Tali mentioned that bosons are of interest even in physics, not only in computer science. But this is a very, very simplified physical system. And it looks that there are some things to learn here which go beyond this study, both what is the analog of noise sensitivity, what is the analog of the Fourier-Hermit expansion for other types of systems, for other types of quantum states, and this is quite interesting.
What does all that you said mean about the boson sampling?
What?
I didn't get what it meant.
So, yeah, this is the second part. What does it mean? So I should say, the question about interpretation is really, here there is some debate, but we will come to that. So the question, what does it mean? Yeah, okay. So here is the picture as suggested by or implied or suggested by our theorem. So when we try to do realistically boson simple, we will witness the following behavior. So A, when the noise level is constant, the resulting distribution is supported by low degree Hermit-like polynomials. And therefore, it is classically simulable. And not only classically simulable, but it's very low, it's simulable by bounded depth circuits. When the noise level is about C over N, noise sensitivity will not allow robust experimental outcomes. I should say there are similar results by Leverrier and Garcia Patron. So above C over N, you will not have robust experimental outcomes. There is another effect. We said, you see, we talk not only about ideal boson sampling, but also about ideal noise. And even the noise is an idealization. And when the noise level is about C over N, when we talk about small perturbation of the description of the noise, this will also lead to big differences. So getting a well-defined distribution required prescribing the noise. So if you ask what nature do when it have N bosons, you need to prescribe the noise in so many parameters. So what you actually do in computationally is you use the exponential input size.
And the fourth point is that in reality, unless the number of bosons is small, it will be simply not possible to control or describe the noise in the required level to achieve a robust distribution. So this is all more or less not very controversial. I think it's very interesting that there is these two behavior, one over n constant. It's also interesting that we have this bounded depth computation coming here, but it's not very controversial. In reality, unless the number of bosons is small, it will simply not be possible to control or describe the noise in the required level to achieve robust computation. So this picture is not so, Nadav is not here, but I think this picture is not so much in dispute and not surprising to experts. And the big question is, what is small? So does noise sensitivity kicks in already for 7 or 8 bosons, or maybe it will move, you need 20 or 50 or 100 bosons. So if the later possibility, if noise sensitivity will not kick in when you try to control 50 bosons, then this will be experimental demonstration of quantum supremacy, which, as I said, will be an off-scale achievement even for the highest form of scientific recognition. So the question is, maybe this is your question, yeah? Is it, so we cannot do 1,000 bosons, but what about, where this picture will come to play? For 7 or for 400? And this is the dilemma, so we...
What do you mean by off-scale achievement?
Off-scale achievement means that the guy who will get the Nobel Prize for it, this will be even outstanding for a Nobel Prize. I don't know. This off scale. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, you should read between the lines how likely I think. Okay, so the dilemma of quantum supremacy via boson sampling is the following: can boson sampling without quantum photons demonstrate quantum computational supremacy? And I think there are good reasons to believe that this is possible, and there are also good reasons to believe that this is impossible. And there are even better reasons to believe that one of the two is not correct. And the amount of reasons to believe it, there are several promising avenues for implementation. I mentioned Nadav is trying to implement it using a superconducting qubit. Some people are trying actual photons and really the classical type of photonics. And there are some nice suggestions for post-selection, which can be powerful tool for some form of noise, for eliminating some form of noise. For some implementations, the building blocks are extremely robust. For example, superconducting qubits can be built with a fidelity of 99.99. So this gives them they're very optimistic about it. And people simply don't see reason why present technology can be pushed to 20 or 30 bosons. So, you know, you ask the experts, they do it for 3 and 4 and say, you know, we don't see why it should not work. Now, reason to this belief, there are 2 reasons. This will be a rare case of practical computational advantage for devices representing bounded depth computation. And here we have a clear computational theoretical reason. We don't expect that a device that asymptotically represents bounded depth computation will be competitive even to good classical devices. This is theoretically possible. We cannot, it's not impossible, but we never, it's rare to, when I say it's rare to witness it, I mean that I don't know any such example, but maybe there are. The second reason is that the dimension of non-interacting bosons is exponentially small in that of bosons of general type, and even smaller when indistinguishability is compromised. So we try to hit something in a very low variety inside a huge Hilbert space, and we have here some sort of, the physics tells us a very clear exponential explosion, which suggests that moving even from 3 to 4 and from 4 to 5 and from 5 to 6 will exhibit an explosion that we cannot. Of course, the priors regarding the feasibility of quantum supremacy in general are most relevant. There are some good news, and the good news is we don't have to decide or what we believe, because we will have much more information in a couple of years. There are several groups of researchers all over the world. There is also in the Hebrew University trying to implement boson sampling with a variety of physical ideas. We will see what will happen. So maybe 3, 4, 5 years.
Maybe I'll just end this, that there is a larger dilemma that I didn't talk about here, the dilemma about our computational world, mundus computationalis, in Latin. Yeah, this is really, so the dilemma is, which of the following two possibilities is correct? One possibility is the quantum supremacy hypothesis. Quantum physics allows and demonstrates superior quantum computation, computational power, and quantum photons. The efficient Church-Turing thesis is false. So this is the common hypothesis regarding quantum computing. The competing, or I don't know if it's really competing, but an alternative hypothesis says classic control. In our quantum world, robust information and computation requires fault tolerance, and the only realistic mechanism for fault tolerance is the repetition mechanism, the majority rule. This is the only way to get fault tolerance. And alas, this mechanism allows only classical computation. So this is more or less the opposite idea. Not only that quantum physics doesn't give us superior computational power, to get any computational power, we need to go from the quantum, from the noisy quantum world, to collapse to the classical reality. And my personal view is the second possibility is correct, and understanding it will have major conceptual and computational application in quantum physics. So let me just move to the last slide. I missed a problem. There is a problem in Latin, which is how to say computational world in Latin. So I had a year-long debate with Aram Harrow about the feasibility of quantum computers, and in the last, this eighth post, we wanted to talk about, I wanted to talk about the computational world in Latin, not that I know Latin. And we had some debate, me and Ken Regan, how to say the computational world. Of course, I didn't have any. I asked my Latin expert, and he asked his Latin expert. And my Latin expert says, mundus computational. Mundus computationis. And his expert, Latin expert, which was his daughter, said, mundus computationalis. And we still don't know what the correct Latin. So we ask for more input from Latin speakers, native speakers. And let me just end with the following question, which is very important, are there convincing examples from non-physics that nature requires exponentially computational speed up? Are there computation from first principle that cannot be done efficiently on our digital computer? So this is a very basic question, and many physicists have the intuition that in order to do what we can do in the laboratory, some exponential power is needed. And it's interesting to check this on a case-by-case basis and to look carefully at such suggestions. I don't know of anything which can be regarded as a smoking gun for the quantum supremacy hypothesis, but there are some nice suggestions. In any case, my view is that the answer is no. And this is, we are thinking about it, some small group here, so I can update you. In any case, this is it, and thank you very much.
More questions?
Just one small comment. Essentially, there's no quantum world and classical world. This is a big misconception. As far as we know, the world today is quantum mechanical.
Yeah, yeah, there's no question about it.
And so classical world is actually a limit of quantum mechanics. If you are right, then quantum mechanics is wrong.
No.
I mean, as we understand it today.
No. This is not correct. This is a misconception. No, if I'm right, I don't think quantum mechanics can tell you. No, quantum mechanics cannot tell you if the noise in our CRM will kick in for 8 bosons or for 50 bosons. There's no quantum mechanic principle which tell you. So if I'm right that it will kick in 8 bosons and not in 50 bosons, it has no bearing on quantum physics. Right? What? No. This is simply a misconception. I think the issue is the interface between quantum physics and thermodynamics. Everything is within quantum physics. There is nothing here. If you talk about specifically about the dilemma of boson sampling, there is nothing in quantum physics which tells you one way or the other. But it's true that what your intuition is a common misconception about quantum computation. that the only, because I think people are excited both by the possibility that quantum mechanics is wrong and that quantum, superior quantum computers are possible, and exciting possibilities are simply incorrect. And it's true that you need to work out what is the correct.
Isn't there some sort of problem in phrasing this sensitivity this way? Because there's no reference to the energy of the Hamiltonian here.
Yeah, there's no reference to that. So this is abstracted the way. We don't talk about energy in any of this study. I don't think, yes, do it. So you should take the Dorit Ishkan, because she's also one of the heroes of this study.
So there is this sort of two thresholds.
Yeah.
One is when the noise is constant, then things become non-interesting, almost also for classical computations. And then there is the threshold of 1 over n.
What do you mean almost also for classical?
I mean,
classical
down the depth.
yeah, so they move to very, yeah.
Yeah, but what I'm asking is, you seem to be hinting that above the noise sensitivity threshold, everything becomes non-interesting, meaning...
Yeah, what do you mean non-interesting?
Non-interesting, I don't know.
Computationally. Yeah, I think above the noise... So there are two ways to look at it. One is that above the noise sensitivity level, we simply cannot create robust outcomes.
But so what? I mean, does it mean the fact that...
The other question is about so what? Oh, okay, this is an excellent question. So you say, okay, it will not be robust, but still there will be some outcome. But another point is that there will be a very strong dependence on the parameters of the noise. Above the 1 over n level, there will be a very strong dependence on the parameter of the noise. So if you want to understand what are the outcomes, if they depend on exponentially many parameters which are needed to describe the noise.
But you have to show that there is nothing that is robust there.
No. I don't say that. Actually, if you prescribe the noise well enough, it is robust.
Yeah, but...
But in order to prescribe the noise well enough, you need an exponential number of parameters in the number of bosons. And then when you have exponential number of parameters, then there is no way this demystify any quantum supremacy. You have an algorithm which takes exponential time, but it needs an exponential size input. So the fact that you have noise sensitivity means that if you have robust outcomes, you know, nature runs these things and there is some outcome. This robust outcome depends on an input which is exponentially
large. Okay, yeah. when you look at the outcome this way, it may depend very strongly, but maybe there is a different way to cut it or to ask the question such that things are robust. That question in particular will be robust even when you look at different parameters of the noise.
Okay, so if you talk about approximating, if the states are themselves Gaussian, then I think this will not be possible. I think the dependence, you will not be able to give up. The dependence will generally depend on, if you want a robust outcome, and the noise level is about 1 over n, then you need the exponential many parameters. If it's not the average case, for example, then we don't know. There may be some specific bosonic states that you can. This is one of the open questions. What for this is a noise sensitive, or it has a large noise sensitivity ingredient. But maybe there are some interesting specific states which some miracles. Okay, we cannot exclude all forms of miracles. We can only exclude what we study.
Thank you, speaker again.